Well, good morning, church. Good morning. Welcome to worship on this Sunday morning. Good to see all of you this morning. Welcome to any who are guests with us today. We're glad to have you here as well. If you're worshiping with us here in the sanctuary, everything you need for worship this morning will be projected on the screen, although there are some bulletins if you're interested in having something so that you can look ahead and see what's coming up next. Also, Bibles and hymnals are there in the pews for you if you like to have the Word of God to hold in your hand, or the notes for the songs, that's there as well. Please take an opportunity at some point to sign the connection pads that are there. It would be on either end of the pew, and let us know that you worshiped with us. We'd love to know. If you're worshiping with us online, a special welcome to you as well. We're glad to have you joining us. Let's give them a wave this morning. Let them know that they are a part of this community and that they are welcome and with us in spirit. If you are worshiping online, please take a moment to just say hello in the comments and let us know that you're with us. There's always something going on here at the church, so let me bring you in on a couple of announcements. First, quarterly contribution statements are at the back of the church in a box, alphabetized, so please pick your, if you're a member or you've been giving to the church, please pick your statement up this morning and save the church some postage. Also, in your bulletin, you'll find the first press deadline. And then we have a very special event coming up on May 5th at 7 o'clock here in the sanctuary. You're not going to be able to see this very well unless Dave can get it on the screen. But we have our good friend Ray Blue coming in from New York. And Ray's going to be bringing his quintet with him. And we're going to have a performance here in the sanctuary. It's a fundraiser for Ray's charitable foundation, the Cross-Cultural Connection. And we're also going to have some Linmar students joining us and playing, as well as some Co-College students joining us and playing. So we're going to have a big evening that night. We are looking for folks that would be willing to greet and show people where the sanctuary is. If you'd be willing to do that, please contact the church office. This event is open to the public and free of charge, so it's a great opportunity to come out and listen to some beautiful jazz. If you've ever heard Ray, you know how well he plays, and we're excited to have his quintet coming with him. It's going to be, as he puts it, a fun musical journey through the history of jazz. So, Sarah, did you want to make an announcement about Earth Day this morning, or?
Good morning. As you may or may not know, yesterday was Earth Day, and we're celebrating it today. And so I invite you all to come down to the social hall after worship. We have two projects to do. We're going to make wildflower seed bombs. You can make some paper seed bombs that you can take out in the country and throw out your car window into the ditches so that wildflowers will grow for the pollinators. And then we have 2-liter pop bottle bird feeders, so please come down. And then also I have some First Pres grandparents who have volunteered to read stories about the environment. I have a bunch of really nice youth books, which I think are always good for adults as well, and they've volunteered to read stories. So if you want to have a story read, go and ask Joyce and Judy and Peg. Is Peg here? So they volunteered to be our grandparent readers, so you can go in the chapel where it's quieter and have a book read.
And as you throw those flower bombs out the window, you have to yell, "Flower in the hole!" Boy, I'm glad you laughed at that this morning, because it sounded better in my head than it did coming out. Well, we would love to stay connected with you here at FPC. A couple of good ways to do that through Facebook, so you can find our Facebook page and like or follow us. Also, we have a Twitter account now. Information will be on the screen at some point that shows our Twitter handle, but it is at First Press Marion, with First Press and Marion capitalized. So you can find our Twitter account that way. We're going to try and keep as much information flowing as we can through Facebook and through Twitter. So if you use those platforms, please look for those. As important as it is to connect online, it's also important to connect in person. So let's take just a minute here before we start worship, and in whatever way is most comfortable for you, take a minute and greet the folks around you. Well, here at FPC, we believe church isn't so much about rules and doctrine in the way we traditionally understand them. Instead, it's about relationships. It's about our relationship with each other. It's about our relationship with God. We believe the most important thing we can do here is love God and our neighbors as much as ourselves. So there is always a place for you here at FPC, and you are always welcome. We affirm the worth and value of all people. Doesn't matter whether you're gay or straight, rich, poor, young, old, wise, foolish. Be who you are here. We believe this is meant to be safe space, sanctuary. That's one of the reasons we call it a sanctuary, where we can express doubts, where we can ask questions, where we can be who we are. And sometimes who we are is not who we want to be. Sometimes who we are is beaten down by the world around us. And so this is meant to be a space where you can be loved and uplifted. And so please feel free to be who you are here at FPC. And we're glad that you're with us. You'll find no judgment here, only grace and love. Well, our call to worship this morning comes from a blog called Hold Fast to What is Good, and it was written by Beth Merrill Neal. When I think of God's presence in the world, I am grateful. Grateful for the presence of hope, grateful for the gift of life. When I think of God's presence in my life, I am humbled. Humbled by the gift of grace, humbled by the invitation to begin again. When I think of God's presence in this community, I am glad. Glad to be surrounded by holy people worshiping our holy God. Well, friends, let's join our hearts and our minds in the worship of God.
Thank you.
Please be seated.
Let us pray. Lord God, maker of heaven and earth, we gather this morning with Easter and new life still fresh in our minds. We come as living sacrifices to offer you our worship and thanksgiving, our praise and our prayers. Be present with us, loving Lord. Through the power of your Holy Spirit, transform our hearts and minds so that we may recognize your presence, hear your voice, know your will, and walk in your way. God of grace, you call us to be different from the world around us, but the world is a seductive place, and we are easily swayed. You hold before us an alternative way of life with different priorities, different loyalties, and different values. But the lure of the world can be powerful. We are easily drawn into following its priorities, accepting its values, and showing loyalty to its gods. Forgive us when we lose sight of what you have called us to do and who you have called us to be, and give us the strength to follow you always. And now, loving God, bless this time of worship through the presence of your Spirit, and may everything we do glorify you. Amen.
Thank you.
like to invite the children and youth and young at heart to come forward, please. Good morning. It's good to see you. So Pastor Jim is going to talk about a scripture verse in Romans today that talks about making ourselves living sacrifices. And I don't think God thinks that he wants all of us to go to a cross like Jesus did, thank goodness. But there are ways that we can sacrifice ourselves for others in that we can think about doing things for others rather than doing what we want to do or what we think would be good for us, thinking about what would be good for others. That's kind of a way to sacrifice ourselves for other people. And I believe that one of the ways we do that is by taking care of the environment and being good stewards of what God has given us. And since yesterday was Earth Day, I'm going to read a book called The Creation, and this is a poem written by a man named James Weldon Johnson. And James was a civil rights leader, but back a few years ago, he lived from 1871 to 1938, and he wrote a song called Lift Every Voice and Sing, which was kind of a song for civil rights and fighting for equality amongst people. And he wrote this poem about the creation, which I think is really, really neat, and I'd like to read it to you. So I will try to show you pictures as I do. And God stepped out on space, and he looked around and said, "I'm lonely, I'll make me a world." And as far as the eye of God could see, darkness covered everything, blacker than 100 midnights down in a cypress swamp. Then he smiled, and the light broke, and the darkness rolled up on one side, and the light stood shining on the other. And God said, "That's good." Then God reached out and took the light in his hands, and God rolled the light around in his hands until he made the sun. And he set that sun ablazing in the heavens. And the light that was left from making the sun, he gathered up in a shining ball and flung it against the darkness, spangling the night with the moon and the stars. Then down between the darkness and the light, he hurled the world, and God said, "That's good." Then God himself stepped down, and the sun was on his right hand and the moon was on his left. The stars were clustered about his head, and the earth was under his feet. And God walked, and where he trod, his footsteps hollowed the valleys out and bulged the mountains up. Then he stopped and looked and saw that the earth was hot and barren. So God stepped over to the edge of the world, and he spat out the seven seas. He batted his eyes, and the lightnings flashed. He clapped his hands, and the thunders rolled. And the waters above the earth came down. The cooling waters came down. Then the green grass sprouted, and the little red flower blossomed. The pine tree pointed her finger to the sky, and the oak tree spread out his arms. The lakes cuddled down in the hollows of the ground, and the rivers ran down to the sea. And God smiled again, and the rainbow appeared and circled itself around his shoulders. Then God raised his hand and waved his hands over the seas and over the lands, and he said, "Bring forth, bring forth." And quicker than God could drop his hands, fishes and fowls and beasts and birds swam the rivers and the seas, roamed the forest and the woods, and split the air with their wings. And God said, "That's good." Then God walked around, and God looked around on all that he had made. He looked at his sun, and he looked at his moon, and he looked at his little stars. He looked on his world with all its living things, and God said, "I'm lonely still." Then God sat down on the side of the hill where he could think. By a deep, wide river, he sat down. With his head in his hands, God thought and thought till he thought, I'll make me a man. And up from the bed of the river, God scooped the clay, and by the bank of the river, he kneeled him down. And there the great God Almighty, who lit the sun and fixed it in the sky, who flung the stars and the moon to the most far corners of the night, who rounded the earth in the middle of his hands, this great God, like a mammy bending over her baby, kneeled down in the dust, toiling over a lump of clay till he shaped it into his own image. And then into it he blew the breath of life, and man became a living soul. Amen. So as I said, this poem was written in the 30s, so talked a lot about men, but we need to expand that to women too, and we need to realize that God is both man and woman, because we're all in God's image. But what I like about this poem is it tells us how much care God took into forming all of the land and all of the animals and all of the plants and especially all of us. And so if we have God's image in us, if God is living in us, then that means that we should take the same amount of care when we take care of the world that God gave us to live in. That's a way we can show God that we love God, and that's a way we can show our neighbors that we love them, because when the earth is clean, the water is good to drink, the air is good to breathe, then our neighbors also have a good place to live, and they can breathe in fresh air too. So on this Earth Day, let's think about the ways that we can care for God's world to show God how much we love God, how much we love the world God gave us, and also to help our neighbors to live the best life that they can live. Let's pray. Dear God, we thank you so much for the world that you gave us. Help us to be the best stewards we can be, thinking not so much of what we can get out of the world, but what we can put into it. We pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You may go back to your seats.
God spat out the oceans. It's a new image for me. God's spit in the waters. It's a great poem, though. James Weldon Johnson was an amazing individual. Well, we're starting a new message series today called Ordinary Faith for a Radical World. Basically, we're going to spend some time over the next few weeks talking about how we live out our faith in our everyday lives, how we live out our faith in a world that is very much a post-Christian place. Religious affiliation in the United States has dipped below 50% for the first time in history. There is more division in the United States and even in the church than I have ever experienced in my life. How does our faith inform how we live each day? How does our faith inform our lives in times such as this? What does it mean to follow God or to follow Christ in the midst of this post-Christian culture? So that's what we're going to talk about for the next few weeks. Sound good? Good, because that's what you're going to get. Well, before we go too deep, let's bow for a word of prayer. God of grace and love, the words of Scripture tell the story of your love for your creation. As we hear them read today, open to us an understanding of their meaning for our lives, and let them find room in our hearts to grow and transform us from the inside out. Amen. Well, what do you think of when you hear that word ordinary? What do you think of? This is participatory, so you have my permission to speak.
Boring.
Boring. All right. Any common, I heard? Plain, okay? Day in and day out. Comfortable, okay? Blah. Okay, I got hearing assistance this year, but that doesn't always work so well. I was hearing law, but you were saying blah. Okay. Well, when I think of that word ordinary, I'm like Grant. I think of the word boring. And ordinary must be just about the most boring word in the English language for me. Who likes boring? Anybody? We don't like boring in our world today. We don't like to be bored. We want life-changing. We want cutting-edge breakthroughs. And we're always searching for what? That next big thing. We like things that are radical, epic, revolutionary, transformative, extreme, awesome, innovative, explosive. I'm sure you have modifiers that you could add to that list. Growing up in the 80s, for me, it was words like gnarly, or tubular, or bodacious, or legit, or rad, or righteous, or dope. And no, I don't mean the stuff that gets you high. Dope in my day meant excellent, although it also meant that other thing as well. But ordinary, if one is the loneliest number you can ever do, ordinary is the loneliest word you'll ever use. Today, everything has to be in bold type with an exclamation point at the end. It's one of the most annoying things to me when I get an email and everything has an exclamation point behind it. I mean, you know, think about it for a second. Does anybody want a bumper sticker that says, "My kid's a mediocre musician"? Or what about, "My child is an average student"? Nobody wants to be ordinary in the world today. So we're told from the time we're young that we have to do things to leave our mark on the world. We need to make a difference. We need to have a legacy to pass on. We have to live up to our Facebook profile or our Twitter handle or the bio in our dating app or our Snapchat title. In our world, being ordinary is one of the worst things you can be. Or is it? Now take, for example, the story of Michael Husmer. Now, this is comes from a satirical website called The Onion. And the story goes like this. Longtime acquaintances confirmed to reporters this week that local man Michael Husmer, an unambitious 29-year-old loser who leads an enjoyable and fulfilling life, still lives in his hometown and has no desire to leave. Claiming that the aimless slouch has never resided more than 2 hours from his parents and still hangs out with friends from high school, sources close to Husmer reported that the man who has meaningful, lasting personal relationships and a healthy work-life balance is an unmotivated washout who's perfectly comfortable being a nobody for the rest of his life. The story goes on. In particular, those familiar with the pitiful man who is able to afford a comfortable lifestyle without going into debt confirmed that he resides just 2 blocks from the home he grew up in, miles away from anything worthwhile like high-priced bars and clubs. In fact, sources stated that the pathetic loafer has never had any interest in moving to even a nearby major city, despite the fact that he has nothing better to do than sit around all day being an involved member of his community and using his ample free time to follow pursuits that give him genuine pleasure. Former classmates also confirmed that the underachiever is apparently resigned to going to his little, small-time, stable, extremely fulfilling job in town each day and has zero ambitions to leave his position and pursue a more prestigious and soul-crushing career path in a real city. A high school friend said of this man who gets 8 hours of sleep a night and has time after work to see his loved ones and take care of his health, "Everyone else left Camden as soon as possible, and he is consumed by a deep sense of apprehension about getting ahead. But Michael's still hanging around the same places from high school, focusing on the things that matter most to him and existing as a relaxed, easygoing person who's fun to be around. I can't imagine anything sadder than that." Michael's cousin, his best friend as a child, concludes the story this way: "Just look at that loser with his contented grin and positive outlook day in and day out. Poor guy doesn't even know how bad he has it." We don't like ordinary. We don't like every day. We like experiences. We like bold. But you know, even though this Michael Husmer is a made-up character, I kind of envy that existence. Anybody else? There's nothing wrong with leaving home, going out into the world, pursuing excellence, driving yourself to be the best you can be, or being an A student or an all-state musician. Please don't hear me saying that. The problem is, as one author I read put it, our values are changing and the new ones are wearing us out. They're also keeping us from forming genuine, long-term, and meaningful commitments that actually contribute to the lives of others. And it's true. Anybody agree with me that we are expected to conform with the world around us? That we're expected to live a certain way, and ordinary, isn't it? We are conforming more and more to the culture around us. And I'm pretty sure the Apostle Paul said, don't do that. If you have your Bible or want to take out one of the pew Bibles, we're going to turn to Romans in the New Testament, and we're going to look at Romans chapter 12 in the Pew Bibles. It's on page 922. If you don't have a Bible of your own but would like one, we have a bunch on the shelf at the back of the sanctuary behind the flowered cross there. Please feel free to take one and keep that as our gift to you. Well, here's what we're focusing on today. Paul's letter to the Christian communities in Rome is the longest letter that Paul wrote. It's also the only letter he wrote to people that he didn't know. Paul had never been to Rome, so this is a different kind of letter. It's not written to address a problem or a controversy in the Roman church. Instead, this letter is written to introduce himself to the Christian community in Rome in advance of a visit. Basically, he wants to lay out his theology for them, or what he believes in the broadest sense of that word, theology. Basically, he's telling them in this letter about the significance of Jesus and the meaning that Jesus has as we think about God, as we think about transformation, as we think about new life. So, in many ways, Romans is the most theological of Paul's letters. And in that way, it may be one of the most important letters in the history of Christian theology. Romans was written before any of the Gospels. So this would be part of what Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John used or drew on as they wrote their Gospels. We often think of the Gospels and the stories of Jesus as informing Paul's beliefs, but in reality, it was the other way around. Paul's theology informed the Gospel writers, and in that way informed the stories that we read about of Jesus in those Gospels. Here's what Paul has to say in Romans chapter 12. We're reading verses 1 and 2. Next week, we'll continue the process. So I'm reading from Eugene Peterson's paraphrase of the Bible called The Message. He writes, "So here's what I want you to do, God helping you. Take your ordinary, everyday life, your sleeping, eating, going to work, and walking around life, and place it before God as an offering. Embracing what God does for you is the best thing you can do for Him. Don't become so well-adjusted to your culture that you fit into it without even thinking. Instead, fix your attention on God. You'll be changed from the inside out. Readily recognize what He wants from you and quickly respond to it. Unlike the culture around you, always dragging you down to its level of immaturity, God brings the best out of you and develops well-formed maturity in you. So here's what I want you to do." Paul sounds a little bit like a coach drawing up a play during a timeout. In a way, I think that's kind of what Paul is in this letter and in this passage. He's pointing his readers back to Romans chapter 1 through chapter 11. That's where he's kind of spelled out his theology. That's where what they've learned is contained. And now he's going to tell them how to apply what they've learned. He begins, I think, by giving the church permission to be ordinary. Take your ordinary everyday lives, your sleeping, eating, going to work, walking around lives, and place them before God as an offering. As people of faith, we think we have to live these extraordinary, extravagant lives for God. That our faith doesn't mean much if we're not doing big things for God. There's this evangelical myth that if you do great things for God, you can expect great things from God. Anybody heard that saying? That's actually an evangelical prosperity gospel. And it's fueled, I think, a lot of what's wrong in the Christian church today. Julie Canlis, in a book called A Theology of the Ordinary, writes, "Religion is often associated with the extreme, with the emotional moment, the passionate choice, the mountaintop experience. It's those hands in the air, tears in the eyes, moments we see at revival meetings or when I was growing up, Christian rock concerts. I don't know how many times I was saved as a kid going to Christian rock concerts, but it was a lot. Because every concert, towards the end, you know, they play this slow, beautiful piece that got to your heart, and then they'd invite you to come up for what they call an altar call. And you pray the right prayer, and you get saved. That's not what we're talking about. You see, the problem with mountaintop moments is that they are few and far between, and often they're usually very fleeting. You know, there's an emotional response until the next day when you have to wake up, go out, and live that newfound faith in your everyday life. Until you have to apply your faith to how you live, to what you do, to what you say. I think Jesus had a different understanding of life and faith. There were mountaintop experiences in Jesus' ministry. We read about those in the Gospels. But more often than not, Jesus' life was lived on the dusty roads of ancient Palestine. His ministry was accomplished in ordinary moments with ordinary people going about their ordinary lives. It wasn't in the halls of power or with the rich and famous. So I wonder, maybe it's time for us to give up that idea of doing epic, radical, extreme, big things for God and focus instead on living out our faith in life's ordinary, everyday moments. Our eating, sleeping, walking around, going to work, going to church, going to school, kind of moments. Maybe it's time to give ourselves permission to be, dun dun dun, average. To be ordinary. Because if you think about it, that's where our lives are usually lived, in the ordinary. You know, think about those biblical heroes. Back in September, we started a series called By Faith, and we looked at Hebrews chapter 11 and some of the heroes that we read about back in the Hebrew scriptures. Abraham and Sarah, Noah, Moses, Joshua, Rahab, and a bunch of others. They were far from perfect. They were not the all-stars. There wasn't really anything amazing about them. But God used them anyway. They weren't extraordinary individuals. It was the God behind them, pushing them to go on, encouraging them to put one foot in front of the other, who was extraordinary. It was that God at work in their lives, their ordinary, everyday, common lives. Think about the life of Jesus for a minute. I'm going to make a statement that some may not agree with, but Jesus' life was incredibly ordinary. It was incredibly ordinary. He wasn't born in a castle. He came into the world in a barn. He didn't wear the robes of royalty. Instead, he was wrapped in swaddling clothes, in rags. Not what you'd think of for the Son of God. He was raised in a town with a bad reputation. He didn't leave home until he was 30. He walked everywhere he went. But by becoming one of us, Jesus took on our ordinary everyday life. If he was fully human, then we have to say Jesus cried. Jesus got sick. Jesus wiped his nose on his sleeve. He fell down. He skinned his knee. Jesus had morning breath. He ate and drank and burped and had bodily functions just like us. He went fishing. He took long walks on the beach. He made friends and enemies. It was an ordinary human life. But in taking on that life, he gives meaning to our lives. He redeems our ordinary, everyday lives and gives deeper meaning to what we often think of as meaningless. He frees us from that need to be anything other than who we are. Ordinary, everyday human beings. An imperfect creation loved eternally and unconditionally by a perfect creator. Now, I don't know about you, but I like the sound of that. We are called to a faith that embraces the ordinary. We don't have to be anything more than what we are. In a world that prizes rugged individualism, workaholism, consumerism, freedom is found in a faith that embraces the ordinary, everyday parts of life. Paul didn't inspire that first century Roman church to transform Rome by telling them they had to live extraordinary, exemplary, impressive lives. Instead, he said, embracing what God does for you is the best thing you can do for him. Don't become so well-adjusted to your culture that you fit into it without even thinking. Instead, fix your attention on God. You'll be changed from the inside out. Readily recognize what he wants from you and quickly respond to it. Unlike the culture around you, always dragging you down to its level of immaturity, God brings the best out of you, develops well-formed maturity in you. I think what Paul is really saying is you change the world by showing it a vision of what a life lived in faith, what a life lived in relationship with God can do. It isn't Christ followers with an extraordinary, explosive, intense faith who are going to build the beloved community. It's people like you and me. Ordinary, everyday Christ followers trying to live the best we can, allowing our faith to be guided to guide our lives at home, at work, at school, to let that faith guide our relationships, to let it guide how we act on our good days, and more importantly, on our bad days. Allowing our faith to guide everything we say and do. Even how we treat ourselves and the world around us. When we live that way, everything we do becomes a sacrament. Becomes that offering, a holy moment in the midst of everyday ordinary lives. Church, it's not about the mountaintop moments. Those aren't what changes the world. What changes the world is taking our ordinary everyday life, everything we do and say, and placing it before God as an offering of faith. That's how we glorify God. That's how we live out our faith in this world. That's how we transform this world more and more into what God wants it to be. Amen. as we go to God in prayer this morning, I did receive a couple of prayer concerns prior to worship. First, we want to remember Kathy, that is Chris McAndrew's sister. Kathy's having a double mastectomy tomorrow, so please keep her and her family in your prayers. And then we learned this morning that Henry Bickle's sister, Marie, passed away. And so we want to keep Henry and Anita and their family in our prayers. We also want to keep all of those who have lost loved ones recently and all of those who are being treated for cancer or for other illnesses. We want to lift them up as well. So, church, let's go to God in prayer. Gracious God, in love you created us, and in love you sustain us day after day. So it's with confidence that we bring our prayers to you, knowing that you hear us and that you will respond. We pray for those who've been forced into slavery or prostitution, those who are oppressed by governments or economic systems, those who are enslaved by personal addictions. We pray for those who struggle to raise their children in the midst of violence or poverty, those who can only stand by and watch as their sons or daughters die as the victims of gun violence or starvation or malnutrition or preventable diseases, or simply from the loss of hope. We pray for those who refuse to participate in violence or injustice, those who courageously stand up for what they know is right, regardless of the personal consequences. Lord, we pray for those who oppress others, who are unable to break free from cycles of violence and anger, who are no longer able to empathize with the victims. We pray for all who suffer this day, whether physically, emotionally, or spiritually. Especially we lift up to you those whom we have placed before you by name and those known only in the silence of our hearts. May your presence surround and sustain each one so that they may know your love and your abundant life. And God, we pray for ourselves, members of your body here on earth. Break down those barriers that divide us from one another. Unite us in our common belief and desire to follow you as Lord and Savior. Grant us compassion and humility in our relationships. Release the gifts that you have given to each one of us so that in us and through us, your beloved community would be built right here and right now by us. Now, Lord, hear us as together we offer the ancient words that Jesus has given us to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Please join me in our affirmation of faith. We believe in God above us, creator of all things, and sustainer of all life. We believe in Christ beside us, companion and friend, redeemer of all the broken pieces of our lives and universe. We believe in the Holy Spirit, deep within us, advocate and guide, who lives with us eternally. We believe in the power of the resurrection to make all things new. Where all things are fixed, creation is healed, and everything fits together in vibrant harmony. We believe in God above, beside, and within. God yesterday, today, and forever. The resurrected God with us. Amen. In response to God's gifts of breath, life, and wholeness, we bring before God an offering of gratitude. If you feel called and are able, offering baskets are located at the front and back of our worship space, or your offering can be mailed to the church or dropped off in the church office. There is also a giving button on the FPC website. Your generosity and faithfulness are deeply appreciated. And now please join me in the prayer of dedication. In deep gratitude for all that you have done for us, loving God, we lay before you our ordinary, everyday lives as an offering of praise and worship. Transform our hearts and minds from the inside out and use us and all that we have for the glory of your beloved community. Amen.
We have fellowship downstairs in the social hall, coffee and maybe some goodies and conversation, as well as the wonderful Earth Day workshop that Sarah has put together. Please take advantage of that and join us. Also, you may have noticed something a little different on that picture of our website. We have a new website. I think it's really cool. We do need to get some new pictures, so please don't email me about the stock photos that are used on the website right now. We're going to update those, but if you haven't checked out the website in a while, take a look. You'll even find a little piece called Diary of a Mad Pastor, which is a new blog that I'm starting, so take a look at that. And now, go from this place with the love of God in your hearts, and may the grace, mercy, and love of God be with you now and always. Amen.